Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more back thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred, war and poverty. Oh,
James Thomas is here to tell it like it is. Here to talk education, politics, business. James is here for real talk without the yelling. Real issues and solutions. This is Tell It Like It Is with James Thomas on 1300 WTLS and 106.5 FM. Online at 1300WTLS.com.
Welcome to this week's edition of Tell It Like It Is, and February is Heart Health Month. And did you know that heart disease is one of the leading causes of death for both men and women in the United States? The good news is, it's also one of the most preventable. Welcome to Tell It Like It Is. My guest today is Dr. William Foster, cardiologist right here at Central Alabama Veterans Hospital.
Good morning to you all.
Dr. Foster, before we go into heart disease, tell us a little bit about yourself.
All right, I'm actually a third-generation physician. I'm originally from Kingston, Jamaica. My grandfather left Jamaica and came to the United States. His brother was actually a porter on the railroad. He sponsored him to come over here, and he did all sorts of jobs. During medical school, he finished at Howard University in 1927.
Wow.
And he went back to Jamaica in his late 30s. He had four children. And, my father, William Jr., my father went to Howard as well. He finished in 1967, and he met my mom there. My mom's from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
Okay.
So I was born in Boston as they were transitioning back home.
What drove you going to the medical field?
I think a lot of it had to do with my family influence. Mm-hmm. You know, like all teenagers or young adults, you kind of have to make a decision for yourself. But at the time that I think I chose it, I think in terms of some of the talents that I had, and just natural inclination, I thought it would be a good fit.
Right.
Now, sometimes everything that you think would be a good fit doesn't necessarily quote fit.
Right.
But with time, I think it's been a comfortable transition. I enjoy it.
How long have you been with VA?
Since 2007, approximately.
Okay. Now, when we talk about heart disease, strokes?
Well, technically, stroke is a vascular disease involving the brain. But if you include a general term called cardiovascular disease, it will include stroke. It will include diseases of arteries in the neck. It would involve diseases of the heart, be it the heart muscle, the heart blood vessel, the heart's electrical system, the heart's valvular system. It would involve disease of the aortic, the tummy, or abdomen, including disease of the arteries in the legs and the veins in the legs. So it's quite extensive.
Hey, so before we go into things we should do to have a healthy heart, let's talk about what causes a bad heart. And what are you seeing amongst veterans?
There are a lot of things that go into the mix as to what causes a bad heart. I'm sure we'll get into a little more detail with each one. But suffice it to say that if you were to liken to baking a cake,
right,
there's certain ingredients that go into this particular type of cake. Since it's a bad cake, let's just say that there are a couple of things that you can't change.
Right.
You can't change the your age, you can't change your grandparents, your genetics.
Right.
So those are what we call non-controllable risk factors. But of the things that we can control, there are several things. It includes how we eat, how much activity we have, it includes high blood pressure, high cholesterol, diabetes, and our weight.
Wow. So basically we need to have on a daily basis, on a basic regimen of staying healthy, whether it be food, some type of daily activity, going to the gym, walking, things of that nature, in order to reduce it.
Just to say it even better, it involves this very quote, sexy term, lifestyle change.
Right. True.
Where if it's part of you, you don't have to look at your notebook to see how I check this off.
Right.
So getting those habits down pat is not easy.
Mm-hmm.
Especially if you haven't initiated them at a young age.
Right.
This is why a lot of health policy is designed in terms of getting kids used to thinking, eating, moving a certain way earlier. Because it's hard to change after you, for example, you start smoking.
Right.
It's harder to stop.
True. How can we get vets? Because a lot of vets, you know, during the military, you're under that habit or that regimen. Getting up every morning at 4:30 in the morning and working out. And then you go into your daily activity, whatever your job may be for that day. But you're constantly moving, you're constantly doing something. And then when you get out, I find that a lot of vets kind of turn off the physical, of course, PT or gym. How can we re-motivate them to maintain that part of it? And are you guys seeing a lot of veterans that are doing it?
Well, vets have a lot of different challenges. The first one that I've seen is that you enter the military, many people at a young age, you're told when to wake up, when to use the restroom, et cetera, et cetera. So when you leave military service, all of a sudden you're your own king. And one of the responsibilities of being your own king or your own boss is that if you don't wake up, you won't eat.
Right.
It's easier to coast, to kind of rest on your laurels, and we forget that the vibrancy of youth gives us a lot of advantages that slowly begin to disappear as you get into your late 30s or 40s. So I think the first point is to remember that we are now the masters of our domain. There's nobody telling us what to do.
True.
And we have to get used to that. That's part of the, I guess, the growing up phrase that occurs even when you're an adult.
Right.
The second thing is that a lot of our veterans have injuries that make it simply challenging to move around. Or they have PTSD, which affects sometimes motivation and other things. The important point to note is you are the one who's going to benefit from this.
Right.
No matter how much I or any other so-called wise person makes or gives good advice, if it's not internalized, the person who loses out is you. All of these things are designed to not only to help you to live longer, but to give you better quality of life.
Right. True. You know, I see a lot of vets all every day is just, and even myself, I find it very hard to get up and continue that regimen of working out or walking, just walking miles or so. But is the heart disease one of the biggest things for vets here? What is that we're seeing here in the Central Alabama area?
Yes, I don't think the effect of heart disease on our veterans is any different than it is around the country. Cardiovascular disease remains the number one cause of death in our country. Stroke is actually the fifth leading cause of death. And you combine them together, they account for at least $320 billion in terms of sickness and death, etc.
Right.
So that we have to account for. So it is a very, very pervasive and significant problem.
You know, one of the things it says here, 700,000 people alone in just 2011 died from some form of cardiovascular disease, and that it is listed as the number one cause of death in the United States. Let's talk about the racial ethnic, because it's also said that's one of the biggest things for ethnic groups, African Americans, Hispanics, Asians, that's one of the biggest diseases for them. Why go ahead?
Unfortunately, the death rates for cardiovascular disease is higher, particularly in African Americans. Now, some of this, to some extent, may be genetic, but a lot of it is explained by sometimes a lack of exposure to healthcare. And quality of healthcare, which unfortunately is sometimes an institutional problem that goes back to several decades of, you know, that needs to be improved. People need to see their healthcare provider as an advocate, not someone to kind of go to at the last minute. Sometimes you need to take care of an avalanche when it's a snowball.
Right.
Sometimes we're waiting until it's an avalanche for reasons, some of which we can control and some of it that needs to be institutionally addressed.
True. Now, what can we do to help vets really understand that this is something that's very important, that they really need to pay attention to this? You know, you mentioned earlier how high blood pressure and diabetes, how would they correlate? Do they move maybe a cardiovascular disease faster, or does that increase it more to happen?
So I made the analogy of baking a cake with certain ingredients.
Right.
We pay attention to this because what you don't know or what you don't do can kill you,
right?
Just that simple. And if it doesn't kill you, it can leave you disabled to a point where it makes life less enjoyable. So the so-called non-controllable risk factors, I mentioned your age, your family history, even though your family history is something you should be aware of, because it makes you more vulnerable to heart disease going forward. But the things that you can control, you should do, you know, everything in your power to address them, because each risk factor that you add, if you want to use an analogy of a train going down the tracks, the more risk factors you have, the faster that train is going towards you checking out Earth.
Right.
So the question is, are you planning on leaving us?
No.
Right. We want you to stay.
True.
And have a good ride. So.
You know, I noticed, talking about family history, let's say a lot of, and I see this just even talking with some of the vets, and just recently I've lost a lot of close friends from high school who suffered, whether it be heart disease, cancer, diabetes, and yet they know their family history, but yet still it's almost like they accept it. Oh, I got family history of it, so I'm not going to really try and combat that issue.
Right.
They just take it on and just move, you know, through the course of their day. How can we re-change that way of thinking?
But if it involves a change in mindset, it involves programs like this one here where we introduce people to the fact that, you know, there's an old song, "Hey, Sarah, Sarah, whatever will be, will be." Sometimes we can make some few things happen.
True. You're right.
So if your family member, for example, had heart disease at the age of 35, you may get increased risk also. But good things you do may prevent it from showing up to your 65.
Right.
And that gives you 30 years with your wife, your children, maybe grandchildren, before you have to think about stuff that your family has to deal with.
Right. True. And plus, with medical care being a lot better than what it was when our parents were around.
Exactly.
We increasing the opportunity of lasting long. Explain the value of screening and the various stress that you guys go through.
Well, as at a relatively young age, particularly if you have a family history, what you should do with the assistance of your provider, your advocate, is to go over which one of these several risk factors, particularly the controllable ones, apply to you.
Right.
And there are ways and actual algorithms developed to put each risk factor into a little model to give you an idea of your risk of a cardiovascular event within 10 years.
Wow.
And if you, and it's done with a simple program that's on your phone or computer. When you put those things in, it involves your age, your smoking history, your cholesterol values, diabetes, blood pressure, etc. When you put them all in, you get an idea of your risk, and it gives you an idea as to how aggressive you need to be in terms of your own health, whether or not you need a cholesterol medicine, or so on. And this is before an actual event takes place.
Right.
So this should be part of standard primary care, something we do in cardiology all the time.
Wow. Now, how often should we have that particular test done? Is it something that's going on amongst the providers, or is it something that we as a vet need to initiate?
There are some providers who do it. We do it in cardiology all the time.
Right.
But it's something that you can research for yourself, and this must be a provider. They can do it for you.
Wow, because I don't think I've ever had one done.
And that way, you see, this is designed to identify people whose risk is a little higher than others. Because what happens many times is that, I mentioned again this idea of cardiovascular disease being like a bad cake with different ingredients. Now, some of us have this cake in the oven for a long time and we don't know.
Right.
The people that we know about have already had events. They've had a stroke, they've had a heart attack, a heart failure, etc. So you know their risk is high.
Right.
So you go at those people hard. But there are other people that you don't know what's in the oven. So when you've never had an event and your cholesterol is okay, how do you figure out, is there something in the oven, or is it almost ready to explode? So that's where this particular screening algorithm comes in.
Wow. That means we're going to take a quick break. One of them. This is Satellite and News Club of Mondays on 1300 AM and 106.5 FM. We'll return.
There are a few who move toward the sounds of chaos, ready to respond at a moment's notice. And when the time comes, they are the first to move toward the sounds of tyranny, injustice, and despair. They are forged in the crucible of training. They are the few, the proud, the Marines.
If you just sign that first
I'm
one
so
there.
I'm so sorry, I don't feel comfortable signing that.
I don't get the math here.
Was this the same car we talked about?
What's this dealer preparation thing?
I'm so sorry, this just is not
what we talked about.
Get the car without the car salesman. Carvana.com, the better way to buy a car.
Where to go, listen real close, I'll tell you what I know. Vance Law Firm will make you smile. Pick up the phone, here's the number to dial. Dial 3-4-ME 3-3-3-3-3 Vance Law Firm. 3-4-ME 3-3-3-3-3 Vance Law Firm. 3-4-ME 3-3-3-3-3 Vance Law Firm. 3-4-ME 3-3-3-3-3 Vance Law Firm.
Hospital. February is Heart Health Month, and we're talking about some of the things you need to do as a veteran or even as an individual
to reduce your risk of having some form of heart disease. Dr. Foster, prior to going into the break, we talked about some of the risks that are associated with heart disease and some of the things that they need to do to prevent that risk. Why is it that, you know, women are susceptible to heart disease as well? Is it, are you guys seeing more women than men getting heart disease, or how does that go?
I wouldn't say more. I think that, first of all, one has to understand that a woman's risk for heart disease kind of goes up closer to and after the menopausal period. So we do have women with heart disease. Of course, we do see at this point a lot more men than women. And of course, those numbers change. In the last 30 years, we've seen a lot more women involved in active military service. Where women are a little different is that sometimes their symptoms may not always be the same as that of a man, or that was written in the textbooks.
Right.
So you have to have a high clinical suspicion depending on the complaints that they have, because they may not be as straightforward.
Quote of this, it says, since 1984, more women than men have died each year from heart disease, and that some of the symptoms of heart disease could be more different in women than men, and that some of them are often misunderstood. Is that, how could, what would someone misunderstand? I know I have osteoporosis, and before I was actually diagnosed with multiple sclerosis, I was being treated for all kinds of other things. And I later found out that multiple sclerosis was probably one of the most misdiagnosed illnesses that there is. Is that the same with heart disease?
It can be, depending on your level of clinical suspicion. I think you have to realize that because for a long time, women tended not to get as many symptoms until closer to the menopause. That there are people who would, I guess, negate certain types of symptoms in women if they were relatively young.
Right.
But there are women, depending on their family history again, or the presence of things like diabetes, who may develop heart disease much earlier.
Right.
So the point is that there's a saying in medicine that not every patient reads a book. Not every patient presents typically.
Right.
So you have to have a certain level of suspicion, particularly if, let's say, symptoms are typical, you do standard tests, the tests are fine, but the person keeps on having the same symptoms.
Right.
And sometimes that's a time to do a little more aggressive testing, particularly if they're still having symptoms that disable them in some way.
And you mentioned symptoms. What are some of the symptoms that just the average person would say, hey, I might need to go and start getting my health check, my heart check? What should we look for? Just maybe.
Well, it depends on a lot of things, including your activity level. But let's say, for example, you're not able to exercise a lot, but you always go up a couple flights of steps 2-3 times a week involving your work.
Right.
And let's say after half to one flight, you just get out of breath or have no energy left. Or God forbid, you have like a pressing, funny discomfort along with that fatigue. Anything that changes your ability to do things the way you did before, that is noticeably different from times past, should be investigated further. I'll go further to say that all of us are entitled to have a bad day every now and then.
True.
So if you go up a flight of steps and you feel extra tired, that just may not be your day.
Right.
But if it's not your day 5, 6, 7 days in a row or a few weeks in a row, that's a trend.
True.
That needs to be looked into.
What? I mean, if we want to try and motivate veterans, I know it's very simple. How much of PTSD is playing a part in veterans not recognizing those symptoms? Lately, all the time, PTSD, I'm saying,
for the last 10 years, when I lived at home, it's been really now diagnosed. Hey, there is an issue with PTSD versus Vietnam veterans. They just didn't use that term or anything. So how much does that play a part in it, whether it be misdiagnosed or just because the veterans not taking action?
I'm not able to give you any objective data, but just anecdotally in my own practice, what I see is people withdraw. For example, if people don't feel they're being listened to, then when they talk to you, you may be just like all the rest.
Right.
So one, they may not actively seek medical care, number one. Number two, depending on the degree of frustration in life, they may not take care of themselves. So they may, even if they're aware of their risk factors, they say, well, look, so what? So sometimes all these risk factors are left unaddressed, and they're not seeking regular medical care. And if things happen, particularly if they have financial challenges, some say, I can't afford to go to the hospital doctor, so I'll just wait it out. You know, I say this because I want people to understand how profound, almost spiritual, heart disease and its manifestations can be. I had a patient, I'll give you two examples. The first was a patient with a condition called heart failure. And heart failure doesn't mean your heart's going to drop dead. It means that it's not pumping out enough blood to the body in an appropriate or efficient way. And he came to me looking very poor, puny. I needed to admit him. I found out he was living at home by himself. He had no family. So the saying, no chick, no shack.
Right.
And it was pretty obvious he was depressed. He didn't really care about what was happening to him. I'm not certain if he knew what medicines he was taking. We took care of him. We got him stable enough to go home. But my big concern was that there he is in his house by himself. And sometimes that affects the motivation of some of our veterans. In the last year and a half, he adopted some very small animals. I forgot the names. And he treats them like his children. When he comes into follow-up now, he's a different guy.
Right.
Because it's not just him. He's now taking care of someone else, something else. So that motivation itself is like a medicine that he needed, right, that I couldn't give him.
True.
It's almost like an antidepressant at the same time. That motivation now, when he comes in smiling, he brings in animals to show me. He's like a different dude.
Right.
And I'm saying, I'm giving him all of these heart medicines, but they're not going to work if you're not taking them. You have no motivation.
That's true.
So that's the first example. The second example is a lady who had what's called ischemic heart disease, that's blockages of heart blood vessels. And her vessels are so small. She has diabetes also that tends to make the vessels really small. The vessels are so small they could not put a stent to open the vessel up. And they're too small to do bypass surgery. In other words, if you do bypass surgery, you want to be certain that if you bypass, it'll work. You don't want to open up someone's chest or nothing. So no stents, no bypass. So she had to live with a certain amount of chest dysfunction every day. If she vacuumed her house long enough, she'd get chest dysfunction. One day she told me that she had a little granddaughter and she had to take care of her granddaughter. And she told me a story I'll never forget. I never want our audience to forget. And what she said is, when she takes care of that granddaughter, no matter what she does, running around, lifting her up, she never got chest dysfunction. Now think about that. Now what that says to me is that despite all the medicine that I was giving her, that her love for that child meant more than anything else. You know, vacuum, oh yeah, that hurts. But baby girl, different ballgame.
Right.
So your motivation, your will to live, your goals in life also affect everything that we do.
Right.
And I've not mentioned it in part of my risk factors, but I've seen enough that someone's attitude to life, their own faith, in terms of what their goals, their plans, loving relationships, make all these medicines, all this risk factor modification even more powerful.
Right.
So, and that's why veterans should not be left alone. Veterans are taught you don't leave your brother out in the field on cover. When you're home alone to the point where the only friend you have is Rocky the dog, and when you come in to be admitted, there's no one to see you, no flowers, no cars, no one to even take care of Rocky. That veteran, no matter what the illness, doesn't do as well because he says, you know what, he cares. Right? But when people are coming and saying, we need to get up, we need to do this,
things
happen a little more.
That's true. Again, February is Heart Health Month, and before we go, Dr. Paulson, what's the next words you want to do to our veterans?
Well, what I would say is that, just following up on the point I just made, it's good to kind of take a stock of your life in terms of where you are, where you want to go, what you want to do, because we want you here. That's the first thing. And in order to keep you here, not just to live to a certain age, but to have good quality of life, it's good to address each of the controllable cardiovascular risk factors that you know. It includes our diet, our weight, our activity, smoking, diabetes, hypertension, and cholesterol. If you've never had a cardiovascular event, and I'm glad that you have not, but if you have not had one, there are risk tools that we can use to identify your risk so you can kind of see where you stand in terms of the chances of certain events happening. If you've had an event, that's not necessarily the end of your story,
right?
You can bounce back. There's several people who fight this fight every day, so you're not alone in this. It's not the end of the story.
Right. Again, veterans, please, if you want to educate yourself or get more information, they can contact their provider as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm pretty sure we have a lot of athletes here at the VA that we can pass out on heart disease to help you reduce that risk of you having a heart disease. So please contact your local vet or your provider and educate yourself on what you can do. And Dr. Paulson, I want to thank you for being a part of the show. We look forward to next month, where we will have Women's History Month right here, and we'll talk about it.